This joint is composed of two components. There are two types. Number one is the radiocarpal joint, which is the wrist joint. Radiocarpal is between the inferior surface of the radius and the proximal row of the carpal bone. Proximal row of the carpal bone is composed of scaphoid, lunate, trichiotrum, and pisiform. The scaphoid, lunate, they are in direct contact with the inferior surface of the radius. Trichiotrum actually below the inferior surface of the head of the ulna, but separated from it by the articular disc. The fourth bone, which is the pisiform, that articulate with the trichiotrum rather than to come in contact with the ulna. So articular disc is separating. So what is important is that ulna head is not directly articulating with the carpal bones. So basically the joint is between the inferior surface of the radius and the scaphoid and lunate bone. Inferior surface of the radius, if you see, that is divisible into two components. The lateral half and medial half. Lateral is triangular. Medial is square shape area by a ridge, vertical ridge anteroposteriorly passing, dividing into lateral triangular part and the medial square part. Lateral triangular part is in contact with scaphoid bone, which is board shape in come in contact, and the medial is the lunate bone, which occupy the square shape area. So the bones forming, the name is given radiocarpal, not the ulnocarpal. Ulna is not participating in this joint, and it only come in contact, ulna, inferior surface of the head of the ulna only come in contact when hand is adducted, and during adduction the trichiotrum presses the articular disc, and then disc is in contact with the inferior surface of the head of ulna. Otherwise, in normal position, this joint is present between the scaphoid and lunate and inferior surface of the radius. Now, this joint is the biaxial joint. And what it has been observed on radiocarpal, biaxial joint mean that one axis two movements and the two axis four movements. So there are four movements at the wrist joint. But on the radiocarpal joint, there are the two movements. One is on the transverse axis, other is on the anteroposterior axis. And because each axis is composed of two movements, the rest of the two movements that occur at the midcarpal joint. The midcarpal joint is between the proximal row of the carpal bone and the distal row of the carpal bone. There are eight carpal bones. Four bones are present proximally, four are distally. In between them, joint is midcarpal joint. And what has been observed that two movements occur at the midcarpal joint. One is on transverse axis, other is on the AP axis. So on transverse axis, we repeat it again that there are two movements. On the one is at radiocarpal, other is at the midcarpal. On AP axis, there are two movements. One is at the radiocarpal, other is the midcarpal joint. So in this way, the four movements are completed and it becomes the biaxial. So two movements at each joint. At radiocarpal joint, two movements occur, which are flexion and adduction. At the midcarpal joint, there are two movements, extension and abduction. So flexion at radiocarpal, extension at midcarpal. Adduction is at the radiocarpal, abduction is at the midcarpal. The abduction and adduction are AP axis, where extension and flexion are transverse axis. Total four movements at the wrist joint. Type of the wrist joint is biaxial. It is ellipsoid type. Transverse axis two movements, flexion extension, anteroposterior axis abduction and adduction. Ellipsoid joints by definition are those in which oval shape convexity fit into oval shape concavity. Rotation on such joint on vertical axis does not occur. So third axis is not operating in the wrist joint only. So there is a oval shape convexity. Oval shape convexity is contributed by proximal row of the carpal bone, and oval shape concavity is contributed by the inferior surface of the radius. So there is no movement on vertical axis, so it is ellipsoid. Articular surfaces, radiocarpal joint is synovial joint lined with synovial membrane, biaxial and ellipsoid joint. Bones forming the joint are number one, lower end of the radius, and number two, triangular fibrocartilage disc with scaphoid, lunate and tricuterium. This has been shown that underneath surface of the head of the radius is in contact with this articular disc, this below color shown, extending from the radius up to the base of the stylet process. So it is aligned, not in direct contact with the tricuterium. This is the tricuterium. Rather, intervening disc is present. So basic joint which is direct in contact is between the radius, between the scaphoid radius, scaphoid and lunate, that and that have impression on the inferior surface of the radius. These are the two bones which are contributing in the radiocarpal joint. The you can see that that these three bones, they make a oval shape convexity, oblong convexity. And similarly, start from the stylet process of the radius, inferior surface of radius, then head of the ulna, and then again the stylet process. If you look this, this is the oval shape concavity hole extending from stylet process of the ulna, extending to the stylet process of the radius. That is the forming oval shape concavity. Similarly, the three bones, they are present in the form of oval shape convexity. And this is the pisiform which articulate basically with the tricuterium and not participating in this formation of joint. Only scaphoid and lunate in direct contact with radius. Tricuterium come in contact with the disc. The lower end of the radius and disc form oval shape concavity. The lower end of radius and disc together form the oval shape concavity. And the proximal articular surface of the scaphoid, lunate and tricuterium form oval shape convexity. So from the ellipsoid joint, it does not articulate with the pisiform bone. Fibrous capsule, it is lined by synovial membrane and is lined and strengthened by the following ligaments. Capsule actually that extend from the anterior border of the radius, and fiber is directed distomedially toward this direction. From the posterior border similarly of the lower end of the radius extending to these three bones distomedially, so that radius can be easily cross over the ulna in pronation. This capsule is lined with so proximally this capsule attached to the anterior border and posterior border of the radius. Below is attached to the mid of the anterior part of the scaphoid, lunate and tricuterium. Posteriorly mid of the scaphoid, lunate and the tricuterium. This is the attachment of capsule. But it is strengthened by the palmar radiocarpal ligament, dorsal radiocarpal ligament, palmar ulnocarpal ligament and ulnar collateral carpal ligament. Palmar radiocarpal ligament extend from, this is the anterior border of the lower end of the radius, to the scaphoid, lunate, and the tricuterium. Similarly, the dorsal also same, from the lower end of the dorsal border of the lower end of the radius to the lunate, scaphoid, and tricuterium, that is extending. From the stylet process to the scaphoid, and below is the trapezium, that is extension of the that is the ulnar palmar, that is the collateral ligament, radial collateral ligament and ulnar collateral ligament from stylet process to the lower carpal bones. Here is shown the articular disc. This is the articular disc which has been shown, and this is the distal radio ulnar joint lower and radiocarpal joint. You can see over here there is a oval shape area, inferior surface of the radius. This is the central ridge which divide it into two. Here is the square shape area, there is the oval shape area which is triangular rather. Scaphoid articulate over here, lunate articulate, and you can see that tricuterium is not in direct contact with the inferior surface of the head of ulna. It is rather separated by this articular disc. This one is the ulnar collateral ligaments extending from the stylet process of the ulna to the tricuterium and then below the hamate and even up to the this is the fifth metacarpal bone. And similarly on other side is the this is the radial collateral ligament extending from the stylet process of the radius up to scaphoid and trapezium, that is two bands they are extending and attach over here. The palmar radiocarpal ligament extend from anterior, this anterior border lower end of radius, distomedially toward the lunate, scaphoid and tricuterium, like in this direction, and they are attached to this midpoint. And similarly from the ulna, that is also extending palmar ulnar carpal ligament which is extending to tricuterium, and same is on the back, that is dorsal radiocarpal ligament and dorsal ulna carpal ligament which extend over here to the proximal row of the carpal bones. You can see over here, this is another thing, is the proximal row is composed of scaphoid, lunate and tricuterium. Distal row is composed of trapezium, trapezoid, capitate and hamate. This space, this red which is present in between the proximal row and distal row, this is space present between the proximal and distal row, is midcarpal joint. This one is the midcarpal joint, this space which I am tracing over here red color, that is the midcarpal, and this one is the radiocarpal joint, and this is the midcarpal joint between the proximal row which is scaphoid, lunate, tricuterium and distal row, trapezium, trapezoid, capitate and hamate. These bones, small bones, they are interconnected with each other by intercarpal ligaments. These are this, and they are interlinked with each other by this intercarpal, which keep the integrity of this row. Similarly, scaphoid, that is joined by the ligaments with the lunate. Lunate is similarly joined with tricuterium by the ligament, which keep this row and keep the integrity of this row. So two rows, they work as a single row. Three bones act as a single row. Similarly, four bones act as a single row. In between them, two movements occur, and here the two movements occur. So there are four movements on the wrist joint, two on the radiocarpal, two on the midcarpal. radial collateral ligament. Number 4, fibrous capsule is attached to the distal ends of the radius and ulna and proximal row of the carpal, scaphoid, lunate and tricuterum. Ligament, palmar radiocarpal ligament pass from the radius to the two rows of the carpal directed distomedially. Dorsal radiocarpal ligament pass from radius to the proximal row of the carpal bones. Ulnar collateral ligament, which I told you, is attached to the ulnar styloid process and tricuterum. Like this, this is a tricuterum. This is the ulnar styloid process where it is attached. Radial, which is attached to the styloid process of the radius and scaphoid. The first bone is scaphoid and it extends from the styloid process to the radius. Movement at the disjoint or flexion is the movement when the palm of the hand and the ventral surface of the forearm approximate to each other. By definition, flexion is the movement when the palm of the hand and ventral surface of the forearm they approximate to each other. Flexion is 85 degree. So if you take the palm of hand toward the ventral surface of the forearm, that is 85 degree. This is the shown the palmar radiocarpal ligament. Palmar radiocarpal ligament you can see from the interior border of the lower end of radius, directed distomedially like this, downward and medially toward the ulnar side. Radial collateral ligament extend from styloid process of the radius to the scaphoid, and even to the trapezium bone. The ulnar collateral ligament extend from styloid process of the ulna, runs from the ulna to the tricuterum and pisiform bone. Same is the the dorsal radiocarpal ligament, but on posterior aspect. Here is shown the ulnar carpal ligament from the head of interior border of the head of ulna to the tricuterum. Muscle responsible for flexion is flexor carpi radialis and ulnaris. So all the flexor which are passing in front of the wrist joint are attached to the carpal bones are flexors. Like flexor carpi radialis and ulnaris, both attached to the carpal bone responsible for. So those muscles which are attached to the carpal bones are flexors. Flexor muscle attached to the carpal bone are flexor of the wrist joint. Number 2 variety is those which are passing in front of the wrist joint to the hand. Although those are the flexor of the digits, but they also flex the wrist joint. Proper flexors are which do the flexion at wrist joint is flexor carpi radialis and flexor carpi ulnaris. Palmaris longus, which is also passes in front of wrist joint, is the flexor of the. Similarly, you can see over here the flexor digital superficialis and profundus. Although not attached to the carpal bone, they pass in front of the wrist joint to the fingers or digits or the phalanx. Proximal distal phalanx. So that is the pass to the, they also flexor of the wrist joint because they are passing in front of the wrist joint. When they are doing flexion at the fingers, do the flexion at the wrist also. Similarly, flexor pollicis longus passing in front of wrist joint, not only do the flexion of the that is thumb, but also the wrist. This movement occurs at radiocarpal joint. This movement, radiocarpal, and it is on transverse axis. This movement is on transverse axis. That is the radiocarpal joint. extension when the dorsum of the hand and the dorsal surface of the forearm approximate to each other. They come closer to each other. Extension is 85 degree. It occurs at the mid-carpal joint. It occurs at the mid-carpal joint. You can see it is the flexion is radiocarpal, extension is at mid-carpal. So on transverse axis, there are two movements. This is also a movement on transverse axis. And you can see over here, the transverse axis, there are two movements, flexion and extension. But the difference is, flexion is at radiocarpal and extension is at midcarpal. Muscles responsible for extension are same picture, those passing behind the wrist joint. That is the extensor carpi radii. Proper muscles which are attached to the carpal bones are extensors, like extensor carpi radialis longus, brevis, and extensor carpi ulnaris. These are the proper muscles which are attached to the carpal bone responsible for extension. But in addition, the long muscle extensors which are passing to digits are extensor digitorum, digiti minimi, extensor indices, and the pollicis longus. The adduction, it is the movement of hand toward the median plane. Adduction is the 45 degree. Adduction is 45 degree, and that is the more range of the adduction. Because the stylet process of the ulna is higher, so that permits the 45 degree adduction. The muscle responsible for flexor and extensor carpi ulnaris produce adduction. These are the two muscles which are present toward the ulna. One is flexor, one is extensor, both work together responsible for the adduction. This movement also name is given ulnar deviation. Ulnar deviation is another name given to the adduction, that hand deviate toward the ulna. This movement occur at radiocarpal joint adduction. Again, this is the second movement on radiocarpal joint. This was also, flexion was at radiocarpal joint. And it is on the anteroposterior axis. This movement occur at anteroposterior axis and radiocarpal joint. Here is shown the flexion. That is the, this is the that is the palm, the palmar surface of the hand and the ventral surface of the forearm, they come approximate to each other. You can see angle between the hand and the forearm is reduced, and that is 45 degree. If you put the hand upward, or dorsum of the hand and dorsal surface of the forearm, that approximate to each other, or angle between the dorsal surface of the head and the dorsal surface of the forearm is reduced, and that is the extension at the wrist joint. And this is also 85 degree. This flexion is also 85 degree. If you bend the hand, if you extend or take the hand upward, then dorsum of the hand and dorsal surface of the forearm, they approximate or come closer to each other. Whereas the flexion of the inflection, the palmar surface of the hand and palmar surface of the this forearm come in contact, or they close to each other, approximate to each other. Angle is reduced in between. So that is the 85 degree. Adduction. Adduction is the movement in which the hand move away from median plane. Away from median plane. It is the 15 degree occur at mid-carpal joint. So you can see this is the second movement on mid-carpal joint after the extension. So 15 degree, why it is 15 degree and adduction is 45 degree? Because the adduction in the stylet process of the ulna is higher. whereas the stylet process of the radius is lower than the stylet process of the ulna, and that does not permit the movement more than 15 degree, whereas opposite is the 45 degree reduction due to higher position of the stylet process of the ulna, and stylet process of the radius is lower, so movement is less toward the abduction, 15 degree metacarpal joint. Muscle responsible for the movements are flexor carpi, similarly like adduction, that flexor carpi radialis or extensor carpi radialis, longus and brevis, two together that responsible for abduction. In addition, abductor pollicis is longus and extensor pollicis is brevis, also assist in abduction. Metacarpal joint, again, which is the second part of the wrist joint, it is between the, because two movements occur on this joint, the radiocarpal two movements, that we have discussed this all movements. It is between the proximal carpal row of the scaphoid, lunate and tricuterum. This is the scaphoid, this is the lunate, tricuterum. This is trapezium, trapezoid, capitate and hamate. This is the forming the distal row, this forming the proximal row. In between them is the metacarpal joint. Distal row is trapezium, trapezoid, capitate and hamate. Ligament are dorsal, palmar and collateral ligaments. Dorsal ligaments that extend from proximal row to the distal row dorsally, that is on the back of the this carpal bone, where the palmar is in front of the carpal bone, extending between the proximal and distal row, and in between the bones, which are present as shown in the previous diagram, and the collateral ligament. Traduction is the movement in which the hand deviates toward the median plane, and this is 45 degree, more range as compared to abduction. It is 45 degree because of the higher position of the stylet process of the ulna. It is also name is given the ulna deviation. This is the normal position of the hand, and abduction is, that is, here is the angle of 45 degree. Here is the, now this is the angle between 15 degree abduction, because the stylet process of the radius is lower than the stylet process of the ulna, and this is also name is given radial deviation. This is the extension of the hand, dorsal surface of the hand and dorsal surface of the forearm, they come closer to each other, approximate to each other, and here is the angle of 85 degree. Here is the angle 85 degree extension. This is the normal position of the hand. Flexion is when the palmar surface of the hand, this one is the palmar surface, this whole, and the ventral surface of the fore, they approximate to each other, they are not in contact, and this make an angle of here 85 degree. Similarly, extension angle is here 85 degree. This is also 85 degree. And that is the flexion of the hand. Here is shown the radiocarpal and ulnocarpal. Ulna, you can see over there, head of the ulna is separated by this articular disc. This one is the articular disc intervening between scaphoid and the ulna, whereas the radius is articulating with the, that is the scaphoid and the lunate, and the tricuteral bone is separating articular disc from the head of the inferior surface head of the ulna, and this is the stylet process. Here is shown the oval shape, that is the surface of the concavity fit into oval shape convexity. This is the stylet process of the radius, and below is the scaphoid bone, and the normal position of the hand, which is shown, that is fine. Dorsal and palmar carpal ligament, short irregular bundles between the bones of the first and second carpal row. Collateral ligaments, they are the radial and ulnar. Radial collateral ligament connect the scaphoid and trapezium bone on the sides, and ulnar collateral ligament, it connects the tricuspid and the hamate. Radial collateral ligament connect in proximal row first bone scaphoid and distal row first bone trapezium with each other. Ulnar collateral ligament connects the first, that is the last bone tricuspid of first row, that is present medially, and the hamate, which is the last bone medially present, is hamate. So below the tricuspid is the hamate, below the scaphoid is the trapezium. They are both are the lateral bones, lateral carpal bones, first bones of the each row. Scaphoid is the first bone, lateral bone of the proximal row. Trapezium is the first carpal bone of the second row, that is connected by a collateral ligament. Similarly, tricuspid is the medial bone last, and the hamate bone is the medial bone of the distal row hamate. Movement we have already discussed with the disjoint movements. देखना फ्लाइट ऑपर